Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Cappuccinos, Cupcakes, and a Corpse, a Cape Bay Café Mystery, by Harper Lin. Narrated by Marguerite Gavin. Chapter 1. I was bent over a cappuccino, carefully moving my milk pitcher to etch a design into the foam, when Mrs. D'Angelo burst into the café. "Francesca!" she exclaimed so loudly that I jumped, pouring milk across the center of my design and out onto the saucer and counter. I sighed and put down the milk pitcher, then plastered on a huge smile before looking up at her. "Mrs. D'Angelo." I tried to sound happy despite having ruined my almost-finished cappuccino. "Francesca," she said again, coming around the counter. She grabbed my hands. "How are you, dear? Oh, you poor thing. I've been so worried about you." She put one hand on my cheek, still managing to grasp both of mine in her other hand. She was exceptionally strong for an older woman. "You precious dear." I tried to keep the happy look on my face as I took half a step back, but some glimmer of distress must have flickered through my eyes because Mrs. D'Angelo pulled me into a tight hug. "No, no, no, you dear girl, you come here." She held me in such a way that my hands were pinned up by my shoulders, as if I had been raising them in surrender when she moved in. I patted the woman's shoulders feebly with the slight range of motion I had in my wrists. "You don't have to be strong, Francesca, you don't have to be strong," she murmured. At that moment, I wished I was strong, strong enough to break away from her grip. I caught the eye of one of my employees coming out of the back room and sent her a "help me" message with my eyes. "Mrs. D'Angelo, is that you?" Sammy asked, putting her hand lightly on Mrs. D'Angelo's back. Mrs. D'Angelo mercifully let me go and turned her fountain of emotion in Sammy's direction. "Oh, Samantha." She put one hand on Sammy's upper arm and her left one gripped mine. Her long red fingernails dug enthusiastically into our flesh. She looked between the two of us. "Samantha, I'm so glad Francesca here has you to help her through this difficult time. She needs good friends like you now more than ever." She rubbed my arm as she spoke, a welcome relief from her talon-like grasp. "I'm doing all I can to help her out," Sammy smiled at the older woman. "I'm sure you are, dear," Mrs. D'Angelo cooed. She turned back to me. "Do you need anything else? If there's anything you need, you know you can come to me or to any of us in the Ladies' Auxiliary, and we'll do absolutely whatever we can to help you. We owe it to your dear mother's memory, God rest her soul, to help her dear Francesca." Mrs. D'Angelo crossed herself reflexively as she referred to my mother, releasing Sammy in the process. Sammy took advantage of the freedom and stepped quickly over to the register, where customers were getting impatient, leaving me to deal with Mrs. D'Angelo and her monologue and grasping hands. I gave Sammy a look, and she smiled at me. She'd hear about it later, that was for sure. But for now, she was the lucky one getting back to work. Out of the corner of my eye, I saw the tourist whose cappuccino I had been working on when Mrs. D'Angelo rushed in, impatiently tapping his fingers on the marble-topped table where he was sitting. I looked helplessly at him, then back at his cappuccino. "Mrs. D'Angelo, I..." "Now, now, dear," she went on, oblivious to the fact that I was trying to escape. "No objections. None of us would have it any other way. Anything for our dear Carmela's daughter. Now, what time is it?" She looked at her watch. "Oh, heavens, I didn't even realize. I'm due at the library for our genealogy society meeting. I have to run." She hurried back around the counter toward the door. "Now, don't forget what I said, Francesca, dear. Anything you need." And she was gone, in as much of a whirlwind as she'd arrived, leaving only a cloud of her floral perfume and some red fingernail prints in our arms. I sighed as I began a fresh cappuccino for the man who was still waiting impatiently for his drink. Not that I could blame him. "I need a nap after that," I whispered to Sammy as we moved around each other in the small drink prep area. "That woman has more energy in her 70s than I've had my entire life." Sammy giggled. "I think she gets it from exhausting other people." I bent over the steaming cappuccino, carefully crafting a rose in the foam. I tried not to rush, but I could feel the man's eyes boring into the top of my skull as I worked. I finally put down the milk pitcher and stood back to assess my handiwork. Certainly not my best, but it was still better than a person could find anywhere else in town, or in most places on the Massachusetts coast. I picked up the mug and saucer and carefully walked them around the counter to the man who had ordered the drink. I set it gently on the table in front of him, positioned perfectly so he'd have the best view of my creation. "So sorry about the wait, sir. My apologies." I gave him my very best cafe owner smile.
"I hope it don't always take this long,"
he grunted. He took a drink without even glancing at the rose I'd crafted. I smiled sweetly. "I really am very sorry, sir." Rude. I turned to go back around the counter. I should have known that when I saw the Yankees jersey. Despite living in New York City for years before moving home, I've always been a Massachusetts girl at heart. And during baseball season, I bleed Boston Red Sox red. Well, I suppose everyone bleeds red, but that just shows how much better the Red Sox are than our rivals to the south. No one literally bleeds Yankee blue. I took up my post in front of the espresso machine, wiping things down while I waited for the next order. Sammy worked the cash register and called out the next drinks to make just seconds later. "I need 2 lattes, please." I set about making the drinks, brainstorming what I would design in their foam as I worked. I steamed the milk for the first drink, getting it about halfway finished before I pulled the espresso. The timing had to be perfect or the espresso would get bitter. Fortunately, I'd been making cappuccinos since I could see over the counter, so it was second nature to me. I decided on coordinating sun and starburst patterns. I made the sun design first, pouring the center circle of foam, then using a toothpick to draw out the rays. Finishing that, I moved on to the starburst. Work, except for Mrs. D'Angelo's interruption, was a cherished distraction from the circumstances that had brought me back to my hometown on the Massachusetts coast. This cafe had been in my family for 3 generations. First, it had belonged to my grandparents, who opened it shortly after arriving from Italy almost 70 years ago. My mother grew up here, making coffee and cannoli alongside her parents. It was her sanctuary when her marriage fell apart, and she needed a way to support herself and her young daughter. Now it's my sanctuary. Like a lot of people who grew up in this town, I left for college and didn't come back. Not for a long time, anyway. I went to school in Boston and got a job working in public relations in New York. The hours were long and the competition was fierce. I was happy at first, but it wore on me over time. I managed to carve out a personal life in what little free time I had, dating, then getting engaged to a guy I thought was the man of my dreams, thought being the key word. He broke my heart, removing his things from the apartment we shared, the apartment I couldn't afford on my own, and running off with a girl from his office. I'd cried for days, pulling it together just enough to go to work, then coming home and crying some more while I packed up my own things so I could move into a new apartment when I found one. I spent hours on the phone with my mother. "Francesca, come home," she'd say and tell me how the cafe had saved her when she'd been in my position so many years ago. But I didn't listen. I stayed in New York to fight for what was left of my life. And then my mother died. I quit my job, broke my lease, and moved back to the Massachusetts coast. I buried my mother, moved into the house where my grandparents had raised my mother and me, and stepped back behind the counter at Antonia's Italian Cafe as if I had never left. So there I was, 2 weeks later, back in the place where I'd spent the better part of my 34 years, creating intricate designs in the artisan cappuccinos our cafe had always specialized in. It wasn't a terribly big place, just 10 two-top tables along the exposed brick walls, and 10 oversized armchairs arranged in groups and nestled into cozy corners. All the tables and chairs were mismatched because my grandparents hadn't been able to afford coordinating furniture when they first opened the cafe. My grandmother had frequented estate sales and auctions, picking up 1 table or chair at a time until the space was full. They're pretty old, but my mother had maintained them by reupholstering any that needed rejuvenating. It was an eclectic mix, but it gave off a surprisingly cozy, homey feel, compared to Antonia's. The stylish coffee shops I'd visited in New York seemed sterile and severe. And of course the burnt dirt water they served and tried to call coffee was even worse than it sounded when compared to the drinks my family proudly made. Don't get me wrong, plenty of little family-owned diners in New York can make a great cup of coffee, but when you get into the espresso drinks the fancier places tried to serve, That was when you got bilge water. My grandparents would roll over in their graves if I ever even thought about bringing in pre-roasted beans, let alone pre-ground ones. That was part of the magic of Antonia's. We did everything, from start to finish. Our milk even came from local dairy farms. Our coffee wasn't the only thing that kept people coming in. We served some food, mostly desserts and sandwiches, but it was really the way we catered to our customers that kept us busy. The cafe was popular with book clubs, partly because of our coffee, partly because of the comfortable chairs, and partly because we let them drag the tables and chairs around however they wanted. As long as they bought something and didn't violate fire code, we were more than happy to accommodate them. My mother had even encouraged them to place their orders ahead of time so we could have everything ready when they came in. Even without the book clubs, we stayed busy, especially during the summer tourist season. I finished the second drink and passed them to Sammy to deliver to the customer's table. Finally, I got a moment to catch my breath. As Mrs. D'Angelo had said, Sammy really had been a lifesaver since my arrival back in Cape Bay. She had worked alongside my mother for years, since Sammy was in high school, actually, and she knew the cafe like the back of her hand. In my first few days back, she had helped me learn the new cash register, taught me the stocking and ordering procedures, and generally followed me to make sure I didn't make a mess of things. Now I relied on her the same way my mother had, working side by side to keep the cafe humming along smoothly. We had some part-time help from a couple of teenagers out of school for summer vacation, but the two of us, plus our two bakers, carried the bulk of the load, and it was going great. Except, of course, when someone came along and started talking about my mother. At those times, the reality and freshness of her death hit me, and focusing on my work became infinitely harder. "I'm going to take a break," I told Sammy as she came back around the corner. She looked at me, her eyebrows drawn together. "Are you okay?" I usually took a lunch break and not much else, so this was unusual. "Yeah, I just need to get some air." I pulled off the apron I wore to protect my sleek black clothing, which was the uniform of the New York City public relations world, as I stepped into the back room. Outside, I took a deep breath. We were in town, but the tang of the salt air was still strong. It felt good in my lungs. It was the smell of my home and childhood. It made me happy to be back, and nostalgic for what I had lost. I closed my eyes and leaned back against the cafe's brick wall. I must have been out there longer than I thought, because the next thing I knew, Sammy poked her head out the door. "Francesca?" she called quietly. "Hmm?" I murmured, my eyes still closed. "Why don't you get out of here? You've been working nonstop since you got back. You deserve some time off." I'd been in the cafe from open to close since the day after my mother's funeral, but that was the way I wanted it. If I stayed busy enough, I couldn't think. I can't leave you here alone. "I won't be alone. I already called Becky to come in. You need the rest." I opened my eyes and looked at her. She had one hand on her hip and was holding the door open with the other. Wisps of her long blonde hair had escaped the low ponytail she always wore at work and were swirling around her head in the breeze. Despite the golden halo effect her hair was giving her, she had a stern expression to go with her assertive posture. She didn't look as if she would take no for an answer. I sighed and looked at my watch. 3 hours to close. Going home now wouldn't be the end of the world. I could make myself some dinner, take a long bath, maybe go to bed a little early. It would be a treat. "Are you sure?" I asked. "Yep, in fact." She leaned to look around me at the parking lot on my other side. "I think I see Becky pulling up now." She waved at me. "So go on, get out of here." I had to admit she was right. I sighed and pushed myself off the building. "Okay, you got me. I'll go home. Let me just get my purse." Sammy patted my back as I walked past her. "You'll thank me for it tomorrow." I fished my Italian leather purse out of the cabinet where we kept our personal belongings while we were working and slid it onto my shoulder. My mother and grandmother had never cared much for fashion or labels, but they had instilled a firm belief in Italian leather in me. Shoes, bags, belts, wallets, all leather goods had to be imported from Italy. Nothing else was good enough. Even after all my years in New York, surrounded by devotees of French red-soled Louboutin, I still swore by Ferragamo, Prada, Gucci, and Bottega Veneta. I straightened a few boxes of supplies that weren't lined up properly on their shelves against the wall. Then I noticed that a couple of them were empty enough that their contents should be combined and the boxes thrown away, so I started cleaning them out.
"What are you doing?"
Sammy asked. "I'm just straightening things up a little bit. I don't want to leave everything all over the place for you to clean up tonight." I knew I was making excuses not to go home.
"Things are not a mess. Those boxes are fine the way they are, and they're certainly not something you need to take care of now."
Sammy took me by the shoulders and turned me toward the door that Becky was walking through.
"Hi, Francesca," Becky said as she walked in.
"Hi,"
I started.
"Francesca was just leaving," Sammy said, cutting me off.
She guided me to the door and walked me outside.
"Go. We have everything under control. The cafe will still be here for you to fuss over in the morning."
She released my shoulders, walked back to the door, and kicked out the doorstop.
"Bye now,"
she waved. The door thunked closed. I sighed, staring at it for a minute. There was no way Sammy would let me back in today, even if I did own the place. And a long hot bath really did sound pretty good. I adjusted my purse on my shoulder and started on what I thought would be an uneventful walk home. Chapter 2. It wasn't a long walk, just a few blocks. My grandmother had never learned to drive, so when she and my grandfather decided their family needed more space than was available in the apartment above the cafe, they needed to look close by. The house they found was a Cape Cod that was old even when they bought it. It was nestled among other Cape Cods on a street two blocks over, and perpendicular to Main Street where the cafe was. The previous owners had adapted the house so it had one downstairs bedroom and two upstairs bedrooms, one for the boys and one for the girls, my grandparents thought. But no children came along, besides my mother, and the third bedroom stayed empty until I moved into it as a child. I decided to take a shortcut across a few backyards, the same shortcut I used to take when I was a kid running back and forth between the house and the cafe 10 times a day. I hadn't taken it since I'd been back because I'd still been wearing my New York stilettos, which weren't exactly suited to grassy wandering. But my aching feet had finally convinced me to dig some of my mother's loafers out of her closet. Fortunately, her obsession with Italian leather, combined with regular visits to Cape Bay's cobbler, meant that her nearly 20-year-old shoes were still in great shape and comfortable to boot. I turned off the sidewalk and stepped onto the grass. The shade from the trees was a nice break from the summer heat. With how humid Massachusetts summers could get, I had learned long ago to keep my thick mass of hair in a chignon pretty much the entire season. As a teenager, I had argued with my mother that black hair made me hotter in the summer sun, and I would be so much cooler if I could just dye it blonde. She refused, insisting it would turn orange. I didn't believe her and bleached it at a friend's house one summer day when I was avoiding working at the cafe. It turned orange, very, very orange. After that, I listened to my mother's beauty advice. I trekked across a few yards, reminiscing about my childhood adventures. As I got close to my house, I saw Mr. Cardosi, the town barber, sitting on his back porch. He had lived two doors down from my grandparents my entire life, and I had played and gone to school with his son Matteo, or Matty as I had always called him. It was unusual for Mr. Cardosi to be home at that time of day, but it was unusual for me to be home at that time of day, too. "Hello, Mr. Cardosi," I called, waving. Mr. Cardosi didn't move. I thought that was strange, but when he sat out back, he usually had his radio turned to the Red Sox game. So maybe he just couldn't hear me. I decided to wait until I was a little closer to call out again. I waved again as I got into his backyard. "Oh," I stopped, noticing Mr. Cardosi's chin was resting on his chest. Was he sleeping? I cut across the yard to check on him. This had always been the kind of neighborhood where everybody watched out for everybody else. I appreciated it now, but I'd hated it when I was a kid and Matty and I were running around causing trouble. I'd never once made it home before the news of whatever mischief we'd gotten ourselves into had reached my grandmother's ears. I walked across the lawn, wondering if I should call out to Mr. Cardosi so as not to startle him, or stay quiet to let him keep sleeping. Not wanting to scare the old man and give him a heart attack, I called out again, "Mr. Cardosi? Mr. Cardosi?" He didn't move. I slowed down as I got to the porch. "Mr. Cardosi?" I said more quietly.
Still nothing. I nudged his shoulder. Mr. Cardosi. He slumped farther over, and I got a sick feeling in the pit of my stomach. Mr. Cardosi wasn't asleep. He was dead. I backed away slowly, reaching for my phone and my purse so I could call for help. I lurked at a distance while I waited for the police and ambulance to arrive. I knew I couldn't leave, and really, I didn't want to just abandon poor Mr. Cardosi, but I didn't want to hover too closely either. I didn't know how he'd died, but I knew the police would want to look around, and I didn't want to mess with things. Besides, being so close to a dead body was a little unsettling. I wasn't too surprised that the police car arrived first. It's a small town, and the police station is just across the street from the cafe. The ambulances have to come all the way from the next town over. I heard the cruiser pull up, and I poked my head around the house and waved. The officer climbed out of the car and approached the house. He was a big, imposing man. Not overweight, just very tall and broad.
"You're the one who requested police?"
he called when he spotted me.
"Yup, that's me,"
I yelled. He strolled a little bit closer, then motioned me toward him.
"How about you come over this way for me?"
He sounded suspicious. His brow was furrowed as I walked toward him. He was clearly trying to figure out who I was and what I was doing there. While everyone pretty much knew everyone else in town during the off-season, the summer brought a lot of tourists, and the officer seemed to think I had wandered off the beach and into trouble. We recognized each other simultaneously.
"Mike!"
I exclaimed.
"Francesca!"
he said at the same time. He held out his arms and I hurried to give him a hug. Mike was another former classmate of mine. It wasn't really surprising to run into him, but it was pleasant all the same. I hadn't seen him since I'd gotten back. He held me out at arm's length.
"You look great!"
Then a shadow passed over his face. I knew he'd remembered why I'd moved back.
"I'm really sorry about your mom. She was such a great lady. Sandy and I would have come to the funeral, but we had booked a trip to Disney with the kids."
He seemed to realize how awkward it was to go from talking about my mother's death to his trip to Disney. He grimaced and looked at his shiny cop shoes. "It's fine, Mike, really. You have your life to live." Mike smiled, grateful for the out.
"So, I heard you sticking around for a while."
"That's the plan. I was kind of in a rut in New York, and I figured coming home would be a good change of pace."
"That's great. That's really great. We're happy to have you back in town."
He chuckled.
"I'm sure you'll see it hasn't really changed all that much over the years."
I laughed with him. "I've noticed. It's like stepping right back into high school. All the old neighbors are living in the same places." All of a sudden, I remembered the neighbor who had prompted the call that had brought Mike out here. The look on Mike's face told me he had just remembered, too. He rubbed a hand back and forth across his high and tight hair.
So, you were concerned about Mr. Cardosi?
He asked. I nodded. "Yeah, I was walking home and I took the old shortcut through the back. When I was coming across the yard, I yelled to say hello, but he didn't move. So I went over to check on him and, well..." I gestured toward the back of the house.
"He's around back?"
Mike asked, starting in that direction, on the patio. Mike took a wide path toward the back of the house. I guessed so he could get a good look before he got close. When he got to where he could see Mr. Cardosi sitting in his lawn chair, he held a hand out to me, motioning for me to stop. He glanced back.
"You check his pulse or anything?"
I shook my head. "No, I just nudged him and he kind of slumped." Mike nodded and continued across the back of the house toward Mr. Cardosi. He rested his right hand on his gun. A cop habit, I assumed.
"Mr. Cardosi?"
he called softly. He took a couple of steps closer.
"Mr. Cardosi?"
There was no movement in the lawn chair. Mike reached a hand toward Mr. Cardosi's neck and held it there for a moment, checking his pulse. He withdrew his hand and pushed the button on the walkie-talkie on his shoulder. He spoke quietly, but I could just hear,
"You can let the ambulance know there's no rush. He's gone."
Hearing that, I realized I'd been holding out some hope that Mr. Cardosi really was just sleeping very soundly, or maybe even had passed out. Not something I'd normally wish for, but given the options, I would have preferred it. Mike walked a wide circle around Mr. Cardosi's chair.
leaning down to look from all angles. I wondered if that was standard procedure or if he'd seen something suspicious. I hadn't noticed anything, but I also hadn't lingered once I'd realized the situation. Mike walked back toward me with a grim expression. I felt tears unexpectedly fill my eyes. So much had happened in my life recently, and this was just one more thing on top of it all. Mike must have noticed my expression because he put his hand awkwardly on my shoulder.
I'm sorry, Francesca. I know you knew him well growing up.
I sniffled. It's not just that. Everything has changed so much lately. I covered my face with my hands.
Sammy made me leave early today because she thought I needed a break, and now...
I waved toward Mr. Cardosi. Mike patted my shoulder.
It's a lot.
He seemed very uncomfortable. I took a couple of deep breaths, then shook my shoulders. It was what I always did when I was trying to cheer myself up, literally shake the bad feelings off me. I wiped my eyes and forced a smile.
Sorry about that. Just got a little overwhelmed there for a minute.
That's all right.
He seemed happier now that I had regained my composure.
Now, I know you told me you were taking a shortcut home. Is this a way you come often?
I shrugged. Kind of. I mean, it's the way I always walked to and from the cafe growing up, but I think I've only done it once or twice since I got back in town.
Uh-huh.
Mike reached in his breast pocket and pulled out a small notebook with a pencil through the spiral at the top.
And this is the time of day you usually come home?
No, I said. He must not have heard me say that Sammy had sent me home early. Usually I stay until close at 8, but today... I thought about telling him about Mrs. D'Angelo's visit, but decided against it. Today Sammy thought I should leave early and get some rest. I paused while he scribbled, then I thought of something.
Wait, why? Did you see something? You don't think someone...
Crime was virtually non-existent in Cape Bay, and murder was practically unheard of. Surely he didn't think someone had killed Mr. Cardosi. Mike looked up from his notebook and smiled at me.
Just trying to make sure I have all the details right for my report.
He resumed writing, looking at me again when he was finished.
Now, did you see anybody nearby? Anybody coming or going? Anything suspicious?
I shook my head. There were a couple of tourists out on the street when I left the cafe, but once I got on the side streets, I didn't see anyone. Mike grunted and wrote something else.
Sammy can confirm what time you left the cafe?
Yes, and Becky had just gotten there. Mike, you're not telling me something. You don't think I did something to him, do you?
Mike smiled at me again. It wasn't the friendly smile from when he first recognized me. It was more of a cop placating a citizen smile.
No, I don't. I'm just establishing a timeline so they know what they're working with when they do the autopsy.
He waved toward Mr. Cardosi.
Case like this, no one around, no obvious cause of death. They always do an autopsy, just to figure out what happened.
I nodded. That sounded reasonable. Still, Mike's tone made me a little anxious, as if he wasn't quite telling me the whole truth.
Helps the family rest a little easier, too,
he said. The family? I remembered Matty. Poor Matty. His mother had died when we were kids, and now his dad was gone, too. He'd be all alone in the world, like me. I brushed the thought away. This wasn't about me, and I'd already had my breakdown for the day. Do you know if anyone's called Matty? I asked.
No, they haven't,
he replied quickly.
Not unless one of the neighbors has seen my car out front and called him, which is actually pretty likely.
It was. In a neighborhood where everybody watches out for everybody else, something like a police car parked out front was unusual enough to raise interest. Should I call him? I reached for my phone that I'd shoved in my pocket. I'm not sure if I have his number. Do you have it? Mike held out a hand.
No. I'll call him in a bit. Just want to finish getting some things down.
He looked at his notepad.
When you left for work this morning, did you take the shortcut or go another way?
I sighed. All his questions about my day were a little frustrating. I took the main road, out the front down York Street, and out onto Main.
What time was that?
About 7.
And did you see Mr. Cardosi?
I sighed again. All I wanted to do was get out of there. This morning? No, I didn't.
When was the last time you saw him?
A couple days ago, maybe more. He was out getting the paper when I was on my way to work.
And you haven't been around the back since that time?
You don't think he's been dead that long, do you? I exclaimed. Mike smiled his vaguely patronizing smile again.
Just asking questions.
A lot of them. He chuckled.
Just doing my job. Now, have you been around the back since then?
No, I haven't.
Have you seen Matt since then?
Matty? No, I haven't seen him since the funeral. Mike looked at me sympathetically, then back at his notebook. He seemed to be reading over what he had written.
I think that's about it.
He flipped it closed, then flipped it back open almost immediately.
Almost forgot. What's your cell phone number? That'd be the best way to reach you, right?
My cell or the cafe, I said before rattling off both numbers. He jotted them down and flipped the notebook closed again. Then he slid it back into his breast pocket.
Thanks for your help, Francesca.
He looked toward the street.
Ambulance is sure taking its time, isn't it?
It did seem as if it had been forever since I'd called. Just then, we saw the ambulance coming down the street, and at the same time, from the other direction, a car pulled up to the curb. The driver hesitated a moment, then opened the door. Flying toward us with a panicked look on his face was Matty Cardosi. Chapter 3. Matty! I shouted, stepping toward him. He didn't even hesitate, just kept running toward where we were standing at the back of the house. Mike, in full cop mode, walked forward to intercept him.
Matt!
He caught Matty as he tried to run by and held him in place.
What's going on? Where's my dad? Let me go. Tell me what's going on.
Matty fought against Mike's grip, but Mike held on.
Matt, you gotta calm down, man.
Mike said as he struggled to keep Matty from running past him. Matty made a few more attempts to escape before he gave up.
Okay.
He raised his hands in surrender and Mike let him go slowly. Matty ran a hand through his hair.
What's going on? Where's my dad?
I didn't know whether to reach out and comfort Matty from the pain I knew was coming, or keep my distance. I ended up stepping closer so that I was barely an arm's length away, close enough to reach out and touch him, but far enough away that I wasn't crowding them. It had been less than a month since I'd gotten the news about my mother that Matty was about to get about his dad, and I knew how much it hurt. Mike took a deep breath.
Matt, I'm really sorry to have to tell you this.
Matty stepped back, shaking his head rapidly.
No.
Mike stepped toward him and rested a hand on Maddie's shoulder.
Matt, your dad passed away.
But he can't...
Matty glanced at me. My eyes filled with tears I struggled to keep from pouring down my face.
No.
He repeated and ran around Mike. Mike caught him as Matty got around the corner of the house to where he could see his dad slumped in his chair on the patio.
Dad!
Matty cried out as he collapsed to his knees. Mike grasped Matty's shoulder.
You can't go over there, Matt. We have to process the scene.
Process the scene?
Matty exclaimed.
What do you mean, process the scene? Did someone kill my dad?
He looked frantically toward his dad's body, as if he were searching for blood or bullet holes or some other sign of foul play.
We don't know,
Mike said.
In cases of unexpected deaths, we need to make sure we document everything, just in case.
Matty sat back on his heels. Mike looked at me and nodded toward Matty. I knelt beside Matty and took his hand. They're just covering their bases, Matty, I said quietly. Matty looked at me as if he were just noticing that I was there.
Franny,
he said quietly. I smiled at him sadly. I hadn't heard anybody call me Franny in years. We heard motion behind us and turned to see the paramedics we'd forgotten about wheeling a stretcher across the lawn.
Francesca, how about you take Matt inside?
Mike suggested. I looked at Matty and he nodded. We both stood, our knees wet from the damp grass. Still holding hands, united in our orphan sorrow, we started toward the front of the house.
Try not to touch anything,
Mike called after us. I glanced back and nodded as Matty's hand tightened on mine. The added reminder that someone may have killed his dad pained him. Mike said to the paramedics as we passed them.
Let me get my camera out of the car. Then you can take him.
Maddie and I walked to the front door. I reached for the knob, but Maddie shook his head.
He always keeps it locked,
he said, reaching in his pocket for his keys. But my hand was already turning the knob. I looked at Maddie and saw him crumple. I'll make sure to tell Mike, I said. I knew we both hoped that his dad had just forgotten to lock it this once. As painful as my mother's death was for me, I couldn't imagine how much worse it would be if someone had taken her from me deliberately. I glanced around as we stepped inside the house. Nothing looked disturbed or out of place. Everything was as quiet and in its place as if Mr. Cardosi had just stepped out to run to the store. Maddie and I sat on the sofa in the front room, where we'd sat many times to watch TV in the afternoons. His house was a mirror image of my own, with the master bedroom on the right of the entrance instead of the left. Unless they'd been remodeled, capes were all pretty much the same. We were quiet, neither of us feeling the need to put our pain into words. That was all I had wanted in my first days back in town, to sit quietly and think about my mother. I stole a few glances at Maddie. I'd only seen him briefly on the day I got back, then again at my mother's funeral. I wasn't in much of a state of mind to pay attention to how he looked either time. I could see that, despite the tension and anguish in his face, he had been aging well. He had grown his thick, dark hair longer than he wore it in high school, but it was still a preppy, businesslike length. He still had the same warm brown eyes. Back in school, those eyes could make me melt. We'd never dated, but that hadn't stopped us from flirting, and he'd been an expert at using those big brown eyes for that. I didn't know how long we sat there. After my mother died, I'd felt as though I'd barely sat down on the train in New York when we arrived in Boston, so we could have been on that couch for 5 minutes or 2 hours. Time passed differently when your life was falling apart. There was a quiet knock on the door before it opened. I popped up off the couch, ready to fend off any prying neighbors, but it was just Mike. I sat back down next to Maddie, who was staring off into space.
Just going to take a few pictures,
Mike said, nodding at us. I nodded back as Maddie continued staring. Mike stepped into the master bedroom, and I saw the flash from his camera as he moved around the room, taking pictures. He went up the stairs next, and I heard his heavy shoes moving around the floor above us. Maddie glanced at the ceiling, then looked back at the spot on the carpet he seemed focused on. I leaned back on the couch and crossed, then uncrossed my legs. Mike came down the stairs a few minutes later and nodded at us as he passed through the living room to the back rooms of the house. I heard the click of the camera and saw the flash as he took more pictures. He seemed to be spending more time in the kitchen than he had in the other rooms. Finally, he came back into the living room and took a couple of pictures before sitting on a chair across from us. Maddie didn't look at him until Mike cleared his throat.
Did you find anything?
Maddie asked, his voice hoarse.
There were no visible marks on the body,
Mike said professionally. I cringed at his reference to the body. That body had been Maddie's dad just hours earlier. At least I hoped it had only been hours.
They'll want to do an autopsy. Standard procedure to determine cause of death.
Maddie nodded.
Nothing appears disturbed in the house,
Mike said.
Can you tell me if your dad drank coffee throughout the day, or just in the morning?
He makes a pot in the morning,
Maddie said, forgetting to use the past tense.
He drinks most of it before he goes into the shop, then takes a travel cup with the last of it.
Maddie wrinkled his forehead, looking more alert.
Did Dad make it into the shop this morning?
Mike shook his head.
I don't know. We'll check on it. Would you normally hear if he didn't go in?
Maddie sank back on the couch, shrugging.
Who knows? Dad would get in a mood sometimes and just decide he wasn't opening the shop that day. I'd drive by and see it closed and freak out. When I'd call to check on him, he'd say he just didn't feel like cutting hair that day.
He shrugged again.
Who knows? You know how Dad could be.
Mike nodded as he scribbled in his notebook. I wasn't sure what recent events Maddie was referring to, but I remembered that Mr. Cardosi could fly off the handle at perceived slights.
I remembered one time when the paperboy had delivered the Boston paper, but not the local one, and Mr. Cardosi went on a tirade. He had been certain the paperboy had done it deliberately, that the editor of the local paper had told him not to deliver it, and that there must be something negative about Mr. Cardosi in that day's paper. My grandfather had taken him our copy of the paper to show him that there was nothing about Mr. Cardosi in it at all. Mr. Cardosi just accused him of being part of the plot against him. He looked suspiciously at my grandfather and the paperboy for months after that.
Do you know if there was anyone who had a grudge against your dad? Who might want to hurt him?
Mike said. Matty scoffed.
My dad's enemies are more in his imagination than in real life. Any close friends, girlfriends, anyone your dad might have been close to. We probably won't need to talk to them, but it's good to go ahead and get it in the notes.
Matty shook his head.
No. I mean, they're the guys at the barbershop, the employees and the regulars, but I don't think he really socialized with anyone outside of work.
Mike nodded and scribbled.
When was the last time you talked to your dad?
He was starting in with the same questions he'd asked me. Matty visibly crumpled.
A couple of days ago. I've been so busy. God, I wish I'd called him. I just had no idea it was the last time I talked to him. Did you see him that day or just talk on the phone? The phone? I haven't seen him since last weekend.
Matty bent forward and put his head in his hands.
If only I'd known it was the last time, I would have hugged him, told him I loved him. Were you and your dad close? As close as he was to anyone. He's not a real sociable guy. Wasn't?
Matty caught himself referring to his dad as if he were still alive.
He wasn't a real sociable guy.
As if using the past tense hurt him all over again, Matty made a choking sound and covered his face with his hands. I rubbed Matty's shoulder. I suddenly realized how lucky I was that I'd spent the hours after I found out my mother was dead on a train instead of being questioned by the police.
I'm sorry, Matt.
Mike looked over the notes he'd been scribbling as he talked to Matty.
Just a couple more questions. Did your dad have a will? Yeah, I think so. It'd be in the safe in his closet.
Mike looked up with his eyebrows raised.
There's a safe in the closet? Yeah,
Matty said.
You didn't see it? I just took pictures of what was visible. I didn't open the closet.
Matty started to stand, but Mike raised his hand for him to stop.
Whatever's there, not there, is not going to change while we're sitting here. Let's wrap this up and then we'll go look.
Matty sank back onto the couch.
What about life insurance?
Mike asked.
Yes,
Matty said.
He got it after my mom died, so I'd have something if anything happened to him. The paperwork should be in the safe, too. You're the sole beneficiary of both of those? Yeah.
Silence fell for a few seconds. Then Matty snapped his head up to look at Mike.
Wait, you don't think...
Mike held up his hand again.
No. Just making sure I have all the information. Like I said, we probably won't need to use any of this, but it's better to go ahead and get it all now.
Matty nodded. Mike looked between his notebook and us several times, then made a face and took a breath.
So, you showed up here at the same time as the ambulance, Matt?
I looked at Mike sharply. Despite his denial seconds before, the way he was talking to Matty made me suspicious. Matty either didn't notice or ignored it, nodding in response.
Yeah, I did. Were you just driving by? No. Mrs. Howard across the street called me. She saw Franny hanging around, and I guess she called here and no one answered, and so she called me. She saw you pull up while we were on the phone and told me to hurry. And where were you when you got the call? I was in the car, on my way home from work. So you just drove over here instead?
Mike said.
Yeah.
Mike nodded and scribbled some more in his notebook.
I think that about wraps it up for me. What's the best number to reach you?
Matty gave him his cell phone number. Mike jotted it down, then looked at us.
Okay. Want to show me the safe?
Matty nodded and pulled himself up off the couch. Mike followed him across the room and I brought up the rear. I lingered in the doorway as Matty walked to his dad's closet and opened it. From where I stood, I could see that the safe was still closed. Mike pulled his camera back out and took a couple of pictures.
Can you open it up for me?
Mike asked. Matty knelt in front of the safe. He spun the dial a few times, then popped it open. Mike leaned in to take a few more pictures. Then he nodded at Matty. Matty reached in and pulled out a stack of papers.
Everything there that you expect?
Mike asked. Matty sat on the foot of the bed and flipped through the papers.
Yeah, I think so. I don't really know everything he kept in here. But here's the will.
He pulled out a stapled bundle of papers and set it next to him on the bed.
And here's the life insurance paperwork.
He laid the single sheet of paper on top of the will.
Do you need to look through these?
He held the other papers out to Mike.
No, just wanted to make sure nothing was missing.
Mike glanced around the room.
Speaking of missing, do you see anything that's not where it's supposed to be?
Matty looked around.
No, I don't think so. Okay, well, if you notice anything, just give me a call, okay?
Mike reached into his breast pocket and pulled out a business card that he handed to Matty.
One for you, too.
Mike passed another one to me. I looked it over, then put it in my pocket with my phone. I saw Matty put his on top of his dad's will and life insurance policy.
Unless there's anything either of you want to ask me?
Mike looked between the two of us. I shook my head.
Matt?
Mike asked. Matty looked up as though he'd gotten lost in thought.
What? No. All right, then. I'll be on my way. If either of you think of anything else...
Mike was interrupted by a loud rap on the front door before it swung open. One of the paramedics stuck his head in.
Hey, Mike, we're about wrapped up out here. Does he want to...
Mike nodded, understanding what was being asked. He turned to look at Matty.
Matt, would you like to see the body before they take it away?
I saw Matty's face go pale. He sat frozen for several seconds.
There's nothing. No visible...
Mike stumbled over his words.
Yes?
Matty croaked, standing.
I'd like to see him.
The paramedic pushed the door farther open and stepped back outside. Mike went out first, then Matty, then me. The stretcher was on the front walk. A body bag containing Mr. Cardosi's ample form strapped on top of it. I almost bumped into Matty when he hesitated on the front steps. The paramedics were standing at a respectful distance, and Mike stepped onto the grass so Matty would have room to walk by. Several of the busybodies who populated the neighborhood were gathered in front of Mrs. Howard's house across the street, gawking.
You can do it, Matty, I whispered.
He glanced over his shoulder at me, nodded, and gave me the slightest of smiles. He stepped down the two front stairs and strode down the sidewalk to the stretcher. He stopped about a yard away, took a deep breath, and walked the remaining steps forward. I stayed at the bottom of the steps, not wanting to crowd Matty. He looked at his father's face, the only part of him not zipped up in the body bag, for a few minutes, then stepped back and nodded to the paramedics. They walked forward, zipped the bag up the rest of the way, and wheeled Mr. Cardosi to the ambulance. They slid the stretcher into the ambulance, closed the doors, got in, and drove away as we all watched in silence. Mike shuffled his feet as Matty stood perfectly still on the sidewalk. Mike glanced at me, then at Matty. I walked forward and put my hand on Matty's shoulder.
Come on, let's go inside.
Chapter 4. Before we could even turn around to go into the house, the neighborhood busybody contingent flocked across the street, passed Mike on his way to his car, and surrounded Matty and me.
Mateo, what happened?
Was your dad sick, Matty? Francesca, dear, how did you find him? Were you just walking home?
What a fortunate coincidence, you finding him. He could have been out there God knows how long if you hadn't happened along. What an unfortunate coincidence, what with your mother just passing.
If you need any help going through his things, Mateo, I'd be happy to help. You know, I've lived just down the street there since your parents first moved in, back before you were even born.
The women's voices overlapped and merged as they went on in their chattering and so-called condolences that all too frequently sounded more like thinly veiled insults and criticisms.
Such a tragedy, losing both your parents and you so young yet. You're all alone in the world now. Neither of your parents will be there to see you get married when you finally find the right girl. Oh, your children won't have any grandparents.
At that point, I grabbed Matty's arm and pulled him through the crowd toward the front door of Mr. Cardosi's house. Didn't Mike want us to look through the house? I asked loudly.
I can help you,
one of the women called. No, no, we have it. We were almost at the door. I know where everything belongs. I spent quite a bit of time with Gino. Matty and I whirled around. Matty had specifically said that his dad didn't really socialize, so I wanted to see who was claiming to be his close friend. It was Mrs. Collins, a widow who lived across the street and two houses down, directly across the street from my house. She was rather well known for her, well, let's just call them exaggerations. I narrowed my eyes at her, telegraphing a back-off message. She stopped in her tracks at the edge of the group of women. Without taking my eyes off her, I pushed Matty toward the front door. I backed through it after him, then slammed it and locked it for good measure.
Thanks for that,
Matty said as I stalked to the back door to lock that too. Satisfied that we would have no surprise or accidental visitors, I walked back to Matty. They should be ashamed of themselves. I glanced around and noticed the living room curtains were open. I didn't put it past a single one of those women to walk through the flower beds and stare in, so I pulled the curtains closed, glaring through the window at the lingering crowd before I did. I walked through the first floor and closed the rest of the curtains before circling back to Matty, who was still lurking in the entryway. That should keep them at least from being full-on peeping toms, I said. Matty nodded and shoved his hands in his pockets as he looked around.
He's really gone, huh?
The aggression I had felt toward the meddling neighbors vanished, and I was filled again with sympathy for Matty. I rubbed his upper arm with my hand. I'm so sorry. He was quiet, staring at his shoes. Then he looked at me.
So, you found him?
I swallowed hard and stepped back, shoving my hands deep in my pockets. Yeah, I said as I nodded.
Did he look... How did he...
I thought he was asleep, I said softly, understanding what Matty was asking.
And you didn't see any...
No. Matty nodded and looked at the ceiling with a sigh.
Thank you.
For what? I scoffed. I'd found his father's dead body and called the police. That was nothing special. In fact, I wouldn't have blamed Matty if he'd been angry with me.
Finding him, calling the police, saving me from the Biddy Brigade out there.
He listed. I didn't do anything special.
Who knows how long he would have been back there if he hadn't walked by.
I shrugged. I'm sure it wouldn't have been long.
Doesn't matter,
Matty said.
Any time is too long.
I nodded sympathetically. My mother had collapsed in public and been whisked straight to the hospital. I couldn't imagine how awful it would be to know that your loved one had been lying somewhere, dead, for an extended period of time. Matty took another deep breath.
Should we look around, see if there's anything missing, at a place that Mike didn't notice?
We? I asked, surprised. We'd been close growing up, but I had barely seen Matty since high school. Even though I'd been thrust back into his life, I didn't expect him to want to share such a personal moment with me. He shrugged.
I don't really want to be alone. And you've just been through the same thing. You're not going to be all nosy and stuff, ask me a bunch of intrusive questions about how I feel about everything.
Well, that was true. The first days after I'd been home, several of my mother's friends had come by, including some of the women from Mrs. D'Angelo's Ladies Auxiliary. They supposedly wanted to express their condolences. They'd seemed more interested in poking around the house, making snide comments and asking not so subtly about what had gone wrong with my fiancé. The people who came by and just wanted to express their condolences and sit quietly with me, drinking a cup of coffee while I stared into space, were few and far between. But they were much more what I needed as I struggled to process everything. Okay, then, I said. Where do you want to start?
Living room,
Matty suggested. That seemed like as good a place as any, so we walked back to the room where we'd sat and waited for Mike what seemed like ages ago, even though it had only been an hour. We worked our way through the house, one room at a time. Matty looked around in each,
surveying the contents. He told me stories about the objects in each room, souvenirs they'd picked up on vacation, the lamp he'd broken when he threw a baseball through the open window while playing catch with his dad, knickknacks that his grandparents had brought over from the old country, trinkets that had belonged to his mother. I already knew a lot of the stories from growing up with Matty, but I let him share them anyway. I knew how much he needed to talk about his dad without any pressure from me. We finished without finding anything that looked unusual and returned to the living room.
"You want a cup of coffee?"
Matty said.
"I know it's getting late. I think my dad keeps some decaf, although I feel a little inadequate making it for the coffee queen here."
I laughed a little. "Whatever you have will be fine." Yeah, I'd been around coffee my entire life, and could tell a good cup from a bad cup by the look and the smell, but that didn't mean I didn't have manners. Besides, decaf or no, I knew I wouldn't be getting much sleep that night.
"All right,"
Matty said as we headed toward the kitchen. He reached to open the coffee pot to put in the filter and grounds, but stopped suddenly. "What is it?" I asked.
"I didn't notice before. The coffee pot's half full. It looks like Dad was only on his first cup."
He pulled out the coffee pot and held it up for me to see. Sure enough, it was only partially empty. Matty paused, staring at the coffee pot. The visual evidence of his dad's interrupted mourning must have brought his grief back to the forefront. Not that I could blame him. He looked at it for a few more seconds, then poured the coffee down the sink. He rinsed out the pot and started a fresh batch. We sat in silence at the kitchen table, each of us lost in our thoughts of our own parents' recent passing. With a lot of people, that kind of silence might have been awkward, but with Matty, it felt completely comfortable. When the coffee was ready, Matty poured us each a cup and brought them back to the table.
"Sorry, no fancy designs,"
he said with a sad smile. "It tastes just as good without them," I said before taking a sip. It did not taste good. Clearly, Mr. Cardosi hadn't spent any more on his coffee than he'd absolutely had to. It was so bad, I actually wondered if there might be something wrong with the coffee maker. I set my cup on the table. I'd had a lot of bad coffee in my life, and swallowed some of them down just to be polite, but I wasn't sure I could manage it with this one. Matty put his cup down at the same time as I did. We sat for a moment, each staring at our cups.
"We can just throw it out if you want,"
he said. I couldn't stop the laugh from bursting through my lips. Clearly, Matty thought the coffee was just as bad as I did. "That might be a good idea," I said. Matty took my mug and his cup over to the sink. He poured them both out, then grabbed the pot from the coffee maker and poured that coffee down the drain as well. He rinsed them all out and left them in the sink.
"Sorry about that."
"I don't think anything you did caused that," I replied, the bitter taste lingering in my mouth. He smiled slightly as he stared out the kitchen window. After a few minutes, he took a deep breath, exhaled sharply, and turned to look at me.
"I guess it's time to go home, then."
"I guess so. Is there anything else I can do for you? Anything you need?"
"I don't know. I don't think so. Not now."
"Okay, then," I said, getting up. I walked over to him and gave him a quick hug. "If you think of anything, let me know. You know where to find me."
"Thanks,"
he said. "Seriously, Matty, I know I didn't want to ask anybody for anything those first few days, but I needed the help. There's a lot to take care of. Just ask." He smiled sadly.
"You know, you're the only person who still calls me Matty."
"You're the only person who still calls me Franny."
"What do people call you now, Franny?"
he asked. "Fran? Francesca?" I shrugged. "Mostly Francesca's in New York, mostly Fran here. Just depends on who's doing the calling."
"I see,"
he said. "Everyone calls you Matt now, huh?"
"Yep. But you can still call me Matty if you want."
I smiled. "We'll see. We're not 5 years old anymore. But you're welcome to keep calling me Franny."
"Will do, Franny,"
he replied. I chuckled softly. "I guess I'd better get going then."
"All right. I'll see you."
"See you." Matty walked me to the door. I headed off to my house and my bed, which I knew I wouldn't be able to fall asleep in because of thoughts of my mother and Mr. Cardosi.
Chapter 5. I tried to help Matty as much as I could over the next few days. He took some time off work to deal with his dad's estate and funeral arrangements, and I cut back on my hours at the cafe. I still went in every day, just not for the full 14 hours it was open. Since I'd just been through everything Matty was dealing with, I was able to suggest some things. Go ahead and file for the life insurance so you can use the money for the funeral. Warn him about others. The funeral home will charge you for those refreshments they so casually offer. And help him with the rest. How about the cafe provides the refreshments? My coffee will be better than the funeral home's any day. It helped that Matty and I had been friends for most of our lives. I was able to pick out meaningful pictures of Mr. Cardosi to display at the funeral home, particularly ones with Matty and the late Mrs. Cardosi, or ones from the special times they'd shared. I helped Matty go through some of his dad's things, even pulling out some mementos of Matty's mom that he'd never known existed. As much as I wanted to help my friend in his time of need, part of the reason I felt so strongly that I needed to help Matty was because I'd been the one who found his dad's body. Sure, he had repeatedly expressed his gratitude to me for finding his dad and all, but that didn't make me feel much better about it. I felt somehow responsible for what had happened, so I wanted to do as much as I could to help out. I wouldn't say that I didn't enjoy spending so much time with Matty again, though. It took several days for the autopsy to be completed, and we obviously couldn't have the funeral until after it was done. So Mr. Cardosi wasn't buried until a week and a half after he died. I was glad for Matty when the medical examiner's office finally released the body. I knew it was wearing on Matty for things to take that long. I saw it in his eyes and the way he carried himself. He didn't magically stop being sad after the funeral, but at least he was finally able to get back to his normal routine and not spend all day, every day, thinking about his dad's death. After we both went back to our jobs, we didn't see each other as much. In fact, I'd only seen him once since the funeral, when he showed up in the cafe one day shortly after the lunch rush ended. We didn't offer a lot of food, just some pastries and sandwiches, but that didn't stop the tourists from flocking in to get something to take back to the beach. Sammy, Becky, and I were all working. Becky was in the back washing coffee cups, Sammy was wiping down the counters, and I was making some fresh mozzarella tomato basil sandwiches to go in the refrigerator case. I heard the door jingle open, but didn't look up from what I was doing, since Sammy was closer to the register. Until I heard her whisper, "It's Matt." I looked over my shoulder. Sure enough, it was Matty. I was surprised to see him because, even though he lived in Cape Bay, he actually worked a couple of towns over. If we saw him at the cafe, it was usually first thing in the morning or just before close. I was surprised by how happy I was to see him. I'd enjoyed spending time with him, but I didn't realize how much I'd missed him until he walked in.
"Hello," Sammy said in a sing-song tone. "What can I get for you today?"
"I got it," I said, wiping my hands on my apron. "Can you finish up the sandwiches?"
"Sure thing," she replied, moving over to my station. "Nice to see you, Matt."
Sammy's cheerfulness and friendliness were part of what made her such a great employee. We had customers who I swore came in just because they liked to talk to her. We also had customers who I thought came in just because Sammy wasn't bad to look at. She had a round cherub face to go with her blonde angel hair and soft curves that I'd heard made men think about cuddling up with her on cold winter nights. But she, of course, had been seeing the same guy for almost 10 years. He lived with his mother and said he couldn't possibly get married and leave her because it would break her heart. Why he wasn't as concerned about Sammy's heart, I didn't know. In any case, the men who came in to flirt with her didn't seem to bother Sammy. I smiled at Matty. "Cafe mocha?" I confirmed, already starting the drink.
"Yeah,"
he answered simply. I looked at him as I pulled the espresso. Something didn't seem right, and it wasn't that he was reaching for his wallet. "Put that away, Matty, it's on me." He didn't argue. Just shrugged and shoved his wallet back in his pocket. Something was definitely bothering him. "Go ahead, sit down," I said. "I'll bring it over in just a minute." Matty nodded and I walked over to sit at the corner table. I made a second drink, that one for myself, while I worked on creating a sunrise in the foam of Matty's drink.
It had been one of my favorite patterns in the weeks after my mother had passed away. It reminded me that no matter how bad any given day was, there was always another day coming, and life went on. I finished it just in time to pour the milk on my own drink. Since it was just for me, I wasn't going to bother creating something terribly intricate. Sometimes I seemed physically incapable of not putting some kind of design in a latte. I poured in a quick rosetta. I pulled off my apron and picked up the two cups and saucers to take over to Maddie's table. "I'm going to take a quick break," I told Sammy as I walked past her.
"Sounds good," she chirped.
I heard the smile in her voice. Since Mr. Cardosi's funeral, I'd actually cut back on my hours, and Sammy was happy about it. She'd been genuinely concerned about me working so much. That cheerfulness and friendliness wasn't just an act. As much as I hated to admit it, I was happier too now that I was working closer to 40 hours each week instead of 100. I set the cups on Maddie's table, careful to make sure his was positioned properly. "Mind if I join you?"
"No. Actually, that's why I'm here,"
he replied. "We haven't seen each other much since the funeral."
"Yeah, I know. I've been catching up at work. They didn't mind me being gone for 2 weeks, but that doesn't mean the paperwork didn't pile up on my desk."
Matty worked as a project manager at a telecom engineering company. He'd told me the engineers who worked under him could manage pretty well without him, but he still had to sign off on everything they did. If something on the project went wrong, he was the one who would get fired, not them. I can imagine. I knew how bad it used to get when I'd take just a couple of days off at my job in New York. I couldn't imagine how long it would take to get caught up after being out for 2 whole weeks. Matty looked at the design in his office.
"Sunrise."
"Yep," I responded. "New beginnings, new life. It's always darkest before the sunrise."
"It's always darkest before the dawn,"
Matty corrected. "Same thing." I took a sip of my coffee. It was much better than that bitter brew we'd had the night Mr. Cardosi had died. Not that I was patting myself on the back. Just about anything would have been better than that foul concoction.
"I almost hate to drink it,"
Matty said.
"I don't want to mess it up."
"But the coffee's the best part," I retorted. "It's the whole point. The cappuccino art is just there to enhance the experience. We eat and drink with our eyes first, you know." My grandfather's motto had been, "Make your food delicious and make it beautiful." He would never tolerate me serving a sloppy mess of food or drink to a customer, and he'd insisted I make it again and again until I got it right.
"You're the designer,"
Matty said as he raised the cup to his lips. His eyes rolled back a little as he tasted it.
"God, this is amazing. You seriously make the best coffee I've ever tasted. I don't know how you do it."
"Amaro family secret?" I smiled, taking another sip. We really did make some amazing coffee. Well, I guess I made amazing coffee since I was the only Amaro left. "Here, have a cupcake." I gave him one of the chocolate cupcakes from behind the counter. We didn't exclusively sell Italian drinks and desserts. After all, customers were crazy about cupcakes, and I made sure we stocked at least 4 flavors a day.
"This is heaven,"
Matty said.
"I always get the chocolate when I come here." "How did you know?"
"You can't go wrong with chocolate." I had one myself. They were dark chocolate, with the most delicious peanut butter filling that our bakers made to perfection. We enjoyed our coffee and cupcakes for a few more minutes before Matty pulled out a file folder. He drummed his fingers on it.
"I guess I should tell you why I'm here."
"I thought it was for the pleasant company and the delicious coffee," I joked.
"I wish that's what it was. Mike called this morning and asked me to come down to the police station. The medical examiner finished up the report on my dad's autopsy, and Mike wanted to give me the results."
He was silent for what seemed like a very long time. "And?" I asked, deciding that it was up to me to break the silence. Matty pushed the folder toward me. "What's this?" I asked.
"That's the autopsy report."
"You want me to read it?" I whispered. He opened his mouth, then closed it again, and just nodded. From the look on his face, I wasn't sure he could have spoken if he'd wanted to. My stomach clenched as I opened the folder. A picture of Mr. Cardosi was on the top, stapled to a report bearing the words, "Autopsy Report, Office of the Medical Examiner of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts," across the top.
I looked at Matty. His face was drawn. I resisted the urge to reach across the table and take the hand he rested there. I looked back down and read the report. There was a lot of medical jargon and terminology I didn't really understand. It went through the physical examination and findings in detail, including specific information about Mr. Cardosi's health prior to his passing. I kept reading, absorbing what I could. No tumors, no significant narrowing of the arteries, no brain abnormalities, no blood clots, some mild arthritis. It appeared that for an older man, Mr. Cardosi had been in excellent health. Then I saw what must have caused that look on Maddie's face. Significant presence of potassium cyanide in blood, tissues, and digestive system, consistent with intentional poisoning. Until further investigation can be completed, the medical examiner's office determines the cause of death to be homicide.
Dear God,
I whispered. I looked at it again, certain I had misunderstood, but I hadn't. It almost looked as if the words cyanide, poison, and homicide were in bigger, bolder print than the surrounding text. But when I looked closely, I could tell they weren't. It was just the horror of them that made them seem that way.
Poison?
I looked at Matty.
Poison?
I said louder, as the weight of it came down on me. I must have said it louder than I thought because I heard a clatter from the back room and saw the few lingering afternoon customers look at me. I gave them all a smile and a little wave.
Sorry.
I hoped they would all just think I was talking about poison the band, not poison the killer.
Matty, what? Who?
I couldn't get the words out of my mouth. I had so many questions. I couldn't comprehend what I was reading.
I don't know,
Matty said.
They don't know. Mike said they'll do an investigation, but...
But what? I asked.
But with the amount of cyanide in his system, death would have been nearly instantaneous.
I looked at Matt, trying to process what he was saying. Do they think someone injected him? Like some lunatic ran up while he was sitting on the back patio and stabbed him with it? Matty shook his head.
He ingested it.
What? Like a cyanide capsule? Like spies used to kill themselves if they're captured by the enemy?
No. More like a food or a drink.
Then it dawned on me. Ingested. Nearly instantaneous.
The coffee!
I gasped. Matty nodded, covering his face with his hands. I couldn't believe it. Someone had snuck cyanide into Mr. Cardosi's coffee to murder him. Then another thought occurred to me. The autopsy report said homicide. Matty nodded. But they don't think he could have... I wasn't sure how to even say the rest. Done it to himself? Matty dragged his hands down his face. After a minute, he said,
No. I asked Mike the same thing. He said that since there was no note and no indication that he might have been considering it, and he still had most of a pot of coffee inside, they're going to investigate it as a murder. I mean, why would you make a whole pot of coffee if you just needed one cup to kill yourself? Right?
I nodded. It didn't make sense. Not unless you added the poison to the pot itself, thinking you might need more than one cup. But even then, why not just add more poison to the one cup? Then I had a terrible thought. Matty?
Yeah, Franny?
What if the whole coffee pot was poisoned? We drank out of that coffee pot. Matty held up a hand and shook his head.
I thought of that. Mike said pouring it out and rinsing it before we made another pot would have probably gotten rid of all the poison, and that we'd be long since dead if it didn't.
That was a relief, although I felt bad being relieved about anything at a time like this. Matty continued.
I'm going to meet Mike over at Dad's house later this afternoon, so he can take the coffee pot into evidence. He said there's a good chance they won't find anything, especially because we used it afterward. But they'll give it a shot.
I took another sip of my coffee. You don't think that's why the coffee tasted so bad, do you? Did Mike say what cyanide tastes like?
Bitter almonds, apparently. But I've had coffee at my dad's before. It was always pretty bad. I don't know if it was the coffee maker, the kind he bought, but I don't think there was any way to redeem that stuff.
I nodded thoughtfully. The best technique can't save a bad brewer and bad beans. I glanced at the autopsy report again.
It was so hard to believe. Even when Mike had been asking us a million questions and taking pictures of the house, I didn't ever really think something criminal had taken place. A heart attack or stroke just seemed like the most obvious culprits, and it had turned out to be a human culprit instead. Matty looked at the wrought iron clock on the wall.
I better get going if I'm going to be on time to meet Mike.
He drained his coffee cup and set it back on the saucer.
Thanks for the coffee. Are you sure I can't pay you for it?
Absolutely not. I closed the folder and slid it back across the table to Matty. Thank you for letting me know about the autopsy.
I needed to talk to someone about it, and I knew you wouldn't say anything incredibly insensitive.
He shook his head.
You wouldn't believe some of the stuff I've heard.
Oh, I think I would. People have said some pretty awful stuff to me, too. It's like they don't even think about what it sounds like to the person they're talking to. Matty picked up the folder and tapped it on the table.
Well, I'm sure once word about this gets out, there'll be a whole new round of gossip.
I'm sure there will. Cape Bay was a small town, and news, especially sordid news, traveled fast in any small town. Matty stood to leave.
Thanks again for the coffee.
No problem, I replied, standing also. I picked up our empty cups to take into the back to be washed. Let me know if you hear anything else.
Will do. See you later.
I gestured goodbye with one of the cups as he left. Then I went back to work behind the counter. Chapter 6. I worked until close that night. I'd found that I preferred to come in around lunchtime and work through the afternoon. I'd always been a bit of a night owl, so even if I got off work in the early afternoon, I'd end up staying up way too late. Then I'd be dragging when I opened the cafe at 6. Sammy was a morning person, though, so it worked out for her to handle the morning shift. Right after Matty left, we got busy again as all the tourists came in off the beach and wanted to get something to eat or drink. One of the restaurants down the street had live music every night, so the evening crowd always had an atmosphere of gearing up for a party. The customers kept my mind off Matty and the medical examiner's findings while I was at work, but once I got home and curled up on the couch with a book and a glass of red wine, my mind wandered back to our conversation. I was still in shock over what the autopsy report had said. The idea that someone had come into Mr. Cardosi's house and put cyanide in his coffee was just unfathomable. Who was it? Why would they do such a thing? It must have been someone Mr. Cardosi knew if he let them get that close to him. But Matty had said that his dad didn't have any real friends. On the other hand, Mrs. Collins had been pretty eager to get into the house. Maybe she wanted to see if she'd left any evidence behind. Maybe to dump and wash the contaminated coffee pot. It was a viable theory. I stopped myself. It was not a viable theory. It was ridiculous. And besides, what business was it of mine? I was a former public relations manager turned cafe owner and artisan barista, not a detective. Sure, I'd read a mystery novel, or 2 or 20, but it wasn't as though I was a professional or someone with any kind of background that would allow me to speculate on someone's motives. Besides, the police were investigating. I went back to reading my book. On my second glass of wine, I started thinking that since I'd been the first one on the scene, I was thinking of it as the scene now. Maybe I did have some qualification to do a little investigating. After all, I'd been the only one to see it as it originally was. I may have noticed something that no one else did. And the police didn't know about Mrs. Collins. They hadn't been there when the crowd spoke to Matty and me. Maybe I should just tell the police about it. But what if Mrs. Collins really was just a friend of Mr. Cardosi and had been making a genuine offer to help us, or even just a meddling old woman? She didn't deserve to be investigated by the police for that. Maybe tomorrow before work I could just go over and have a neighborly little chat with her. I wondered if she was still awake. I got up off the couch and crept across the living room to peep out the blinds. Mrs. Collins's house was dark. Of course it was. It was after 10, and all the old folks on our street went to bed by 9. I went back to the couch and curled back up with my book and my wine. I tried to think over what else I had seen that night that Mike might not have noticed. I remembered that the front door had been unlocked when Matty and I went in. I was supposed to tell Mike about it, but it had completely slipped my mind. And Maddie's too, I guessed. That was another clue. A clue. I scoffed at myself.
No, I really was being ridiculous, thinking about clues and suspects. Even so, I got up and found a notepad by the phone to make some notes on. Notes of things I had to remember to mention to the police, I told myself, not notes about what investigating I was going to do, although it wouldn't hurt to at least check a few things before I went to the police with them. I didn't want to bother Mike with a bunch of details that seemed relevant to me when he probably had much more important leads to chase. I wrote down odd things I remembered. Mrs. Collins, the door. Then I thought that it might be good for me to write down everything exactly as I remembered it before my memory faded. It had already been weeks since the murder, and even though I thought I remembered everything clearly, I'd probably forgotten more details than I realized. I thought I remembered something about that from my college psychology class, something about how memories fade and get altered. That was why I needed to write everything down now. I flipped to a fresh page and wrote down absolutely everything I could remember about that day, starting from my walk home. I read something once about how you can remember more if you tie it to sense memories, so I wrote down the color of the sky, the temperature, how windy it was, what the grass had smelled like, every sight, sound, or smell I could remember. Then I thought about how Mike had asked about the last time I saw Mr. Cardosi. So I flipped to another page and wrote down everything I remembered about every encounter I'd had with him since I got back to town. By the time I was finished, it was well after midnight, and I was itching to talk to Matty to see if he remembered something that I'd forgotten. I could ask him more about some of what he'd said to Mike, specifically what he'd said about Mr. Cardosi's enemies being more in his head than in real life. Apparently, at least one of those enemies was in real life. It was way too late to call, so I pulled out my cell phone and sent Matty a text, asking if he wanted to meet for breakfast. Getting up that early would be rough, but I wanted to talk to Matty as soon as possible. I went upstairs to my old childhood bedroom and got ready to go to sleep. I plugged my phone into the wall next to the bed and made sure the volume was turned all the way up. I wanted to make sure I heard it if Matty texted me back, so I put the phone right next to my head. I thought it would be impossible to fall asleep with all the thoughts whirling through my head, but it seemed like only a few seconds later, Matty was texting me at 6 a.m. I jumped out of bed with more energy than I remembered having in the morning since high school and got dressed as quickly as I could. I took the long way to the cafe, out along the street instead of cutting through the neighbors' backyards. I hadn't taken the shortcut since the day Mr. Cardosi died, and I wasn't sure I'd be up to it again for a long time. Part of me thought I should always take it in case someone else was dead in their backyard, waiting to be discovered by a passerby, but the more logical part of me prevailed. Either that or I gave in to the fear that I actually would find another body. I guess it just depended how I looked at it. I got to the cafe before Matty, so I hurried in behind the counter to fix our drinks. Matty always, like since high school, got a cafe mocha. So I didn't have to wait for him to arrive to find out what he wanted. Francesca? Sammy asked as I grabbed cups and saucers. Yeah? You know it's 6:30 in the morning, right? Oh, yeah, I know, I said. Are you feeling okay? Yeah, why? Sammy just looked at me for a second. Because it's 6:30 in the morning, and you're here, and you're perky. Oh, I'm just meeting Matty for breakfast. Matt Cardosi.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.